TI is going to be facility, so I'm going to be talking. And talking about all this stuff. So, so Richard graduated from Caltech. He's got time at Northwestern at Penn State, and he's currently at Milwaukee. And he's a member of Library of Science Collaboration, which is how I met him. And just a
so, I don't think I have to say that it would be really interesting to see a gravitational wave signature.
But it would.
Gravitational waves propagate through everything. They're unimpeded by matter in between us and most energy across in the universe. And so we can learn a lot about things that we would be otherwise be completely unable to see. For example, binary black holes. We don't see them. We do see
they could be placed in the back of that.
So in this talk, I'm not going to talk about supermassive black holes. I'm going to talk about low mass compact objects. Low mass compact objects, stellar mass compact objects, the products of stellar evolution. And what we hope to do is, once we see gravitational waves, is SBR, and do all these things that a lot of people care about. But since I'm speaking to Astrid for the second, the reason that I personally really care about it is because it's a tool to reach out into the universe and see things that will be otherwise accessible. In particular, it gives us a census of how many emerging compact binaries there are out there. It tells us what they are and what they've done. And we can use that information to make inferences about how you process gas through star formation and into the products of binary evolution. Emerging binaries, neutron stars that have been kicked, and shooting through the Milky Way, and so on and so forth. And so the procedure that we're going to use is the same procedure we use for pretty much every other astronomical census. You look out and see what's out there. You say, all right, count up the number of sources that you have. Then you say, well, I know how my detector works, because I built it. And if I know how my detector works, I can say, let's look at the population of neutron stars in the Milky Way, for example. We know how often we see pulsars. We know how bright they are. We know how far away some of them are. Let's ignore electron density problem. And so based on where we see pulsars, how bright they look, their spin distribution, their pulse shapes, we can infer how likely it is for us to see a new pulsar. And then we can therefore infer, based on that knowledge, how many pulsars, based on the number we've seen, that are actually there. And so this is a plot of an example of those inferences. In this case, we're looking at binary pulsars, these color curves for individual binary pulsars, and this is a composite, this is plot of the log of the birth rate of these pulsars, and you can see that for each one, for some statistics, if you have one measurement, you have some information, but as you get more and more measurements, you get more information. In this case, these things occur with, these have short overall lifetimes, so we know that the birth rate is at least has to be sufficient to produce all these, and the composite is here narrower than the statistics you could get from that. And the idea is, with gravitational wave astronomy, is that we'll be able to do that. Not only get an event rate, how often binary compact objects form, but we'll also be able to say what they are, what their spins are, what their properties are, which is fantastic, because that will give us a very tight constraint, which I'll get to the end of the talk, on how you convert gas into compact binaries, like binary pulsars. Now, binary pulsars are great because we see them. We know they exist. They're an example of a gravitational wave source that we will eventually see with LIGO. Maybe we've already seen it, I think you have to say. For black hole binaries, for bubble black holes, and for black hole neutron stars, we don't really have one to look for. So what we can do is, in this case, we can extrapolate. We can't extrapolate because there's no statistics. In fact, we can extrapolate not only from the entire Milky Way, we can extrapolate to the entire universe and figure out how many sources of LIGO is there by saying roughly how much star formation has occurred throughout the universe that is comparable in the Milky Way. We have to rely on theory. And that's fine. You can do these calculations and say, all right, how often can I produce emerging binary neutron stars or neutron black holes? And you try to get them to reproduce various properties of milkmen. Like, for example, this. You have to get the right number of stars in the Milky Way.
But the Milky Way is, in some sense, a typical place, if it's typical. This is a circular bit of logic, but an important one, in that what if the important thing for gravitational waves isn't the thing that's important to produce double neutron stars that we see nowadays in the Milky Way? What if the thing that we see with gravitational waves is something that's biased towards peculiar star formation? And in fact, that is what our calculation suggests. So this is a plot of the log of metallicity versus a very simple estimate, very preliminary. Probably shouldn't even show this. The log of the event rate, the initial LIGO, don't tell anyone I said that. This is my astrophysics now. What you would expect if all star formation occurred at that point. And so if you extrapolate from the Milky Way and do various things, you can get various answers. And you can use different star formation models. You can use includes the contribution of the clusters. So you get a range of broad range. This is a few orders of magnitude. But you'll notice, if you start trying to metallicity, it is a very strong slope towards producing more compact objects at low metallicity. So you will hear about in considerable detail.
So this is integrating over all the volume that you should have seen with LIGO, knowing something about the metallicity.
So this is basically, we take a, LIGO is basically, LIGO is basically something as theta. And LIGO basically has a detection volume. So let's pretend that it's a circle or a double neutron star. For black holes of, let's say, 10 solar masses, the range you can see is roughly linear in time. So if they're, you know, 1, 10, I can't, 10 is a long scale, because I can't draw this. So, in some sense, this bias is simply a fact of, in low metallicity environments, you make more massive compact objects. And LIGO is even farther away.
But it's just that you're assuming everything is at this metallicity.
Yes, I'm assuming you have all star formation for this metallicity. So this is the absolute 100% upper limit that you could get if everything happened there. But even if some of it happened there, you can see it doesn't take very much of a mixture to make a big difference. And this is particularly true because gravitational radiation is really weak. So if you take two merging, two binaries that are eventually going to merge, and send them to spin, gravitational radiation at the start, if they're going to merge eventually, they spend most of their time far away and trying to overcome that early on. And so what ends up happening as a result, so this is a plot of the log, if you have a burst of star formation at t equals zero, and you see how many binaries emerge out of that burst of star forming gas after a time t. And this is the fraction of them out of all of the things that form binary black holes in the case. And ignore the fact that they're regrets. And these are, basically, including both threats, these are different models. And you can see that the cumulative, basically, it's impossible to form emerging black hole binary less than one lifetime of mass stars, obviously. However, at very light times, you'll form a universe. You'll form a significant fraction. And this fraction increases very dramatically with time. Much more steeply than you would with double neutron stars. Because double neutron stars are often driven together by supernovae. Now this is important because if you preferentially have a long delay between formation and merger, the only way that you can get them to form now is if they were born 80 years ago, basically. That environment is naturally low metallicity. So you should then realize, okay, if I didn't include this in everything that I see now, even if I had done the calculation with regular solar metallicity from here to the beginning of the universe, and everything I see now had been actually formed 10 years ago, I really often used the metallicity 10 years ago. Okay, that's fine. You can say, all right, how do metals evolve over time? Use your favorite reprocessing model, fast metals, your electrical heavy. Except there's one other additional complication, is that this is a really strong effect. This is multiple orders of magnitude with a very sharp rate near solar metallicity. And if you look at the distribution of metals in galaxies at any time, they don't all have the same metallicity. Stars don't, you don't take a bundle of gas and just each bundle holds stars at the same rate. There's a star formation rate, there's density and feedback. And when you assemble a galaxy, so this is a model as a function of time and metallicity for the Milky Way. So these dots show different structures being added as a function of time and the metals going up. And you can see that even at any individual time, even at late time, there's a fairly broad spread. And remember, this is the same spread where most of that gradient was occurring, where you would rise by several orders of magnitude over a third of a metallicity range. And anything down here is well into the region where you're producing a lot of things on the primary.
What are the colors in the
diagram? What are the colors in this diagram? More max.
The light is more massive?
Yeah, so this is a cell. So the dark should be low mass, very low mass, and as you get more, there should be higher and higher density in that cell. So imagine taking all points of accumulation and saying each bundle of star-forming gas has a time. And say at each time in your grid, and all the bundles that are associated with this halo, you say, okay, I have these bundles in this, I have this metallicity coming and put them in this bin. And then you go to the next time step and you say, all right, let's list all of the bundles that start from the gas, or all the bundles of stuff matter that is in the simulation that associated with this halo this time. And I have this set of bins, and I bin them up and put them in this bin if they have this metallicity. In this case, there's only that one, and so on and so forth. So at each time, you're basically making history of the metallicity distribution. So this is a paper product. Basic chromosome, but you can see a similar sort of result in basically any cosmological structure model where you're watching the information from that. Now I'm not here as a LIGO person, so I'm not really going to say much about LIGO, except to point out that it operates, and if you were to make some extrapolations based on what it can see and what you can predict, well, I mean, you saw my first slide, and with my anthropologist hat on, I can say that those numbers were greater than what micro could see, and those, if you were comparing them to what micro could see based on a simple theoretical model, and these numbers are comparable. So this puts us in direct confrontation with the experiment. You can test it. This is not something that is far, far in the future. It's not even 4 years in the future. We're at a point where observations can confront what we think is a reasonable model for performing on a topic. So that was my outline, basically telling you that metallicity matters. So in the rest of this talk, I'm going to tell you, elaborate in more detail, on why we're so sensitive to metallicity. Basically, star formation of low metallicity favors high-mass topics that emerge more efficiently. I'm going to comment a little bit at more length on metallicity distribution expecting inference, and then I'm going to talk about how you might be able to test this specifically, not just a large number of events, but also to disentangle the metallicity distribution using gravitational wave observations, not actually like a third generation detector. And let's start with more references. So as you all know, stars evolve. And if you put one star close to another star, as it evolves, it can go through its guide phase to transfer mass to its companion. And this process can be complicated because stellar evolution is complicated. And it's all further complicated by the presence of supernova and by the fact that there are not exactly detailed heterodynamical models for each one of these stages and each one of these mass transfer events. And there's a lot of phenomenology involved. The key point, however, to understand why metallicity is so important is fairly simple. It's that in order to get something close at the end of your evolution, close means it has to merge. Close means that its separation needs to be enough, close enough, that gravitational waves will drive you into merger, and
And that means that it has to be much, much tighter than the giant phase, typical size of a giant star. And so therefore, you have to recognize. You can't get around. And in particular, you almost always have to go through what's denoted a common envelope phase, which is a fairly self-explanatory statement that means I have one star, and the other star expands, and it expands until it overfills its Roche slope, and this star is basically spiraling in through the common envelope of both stars. And the gravitational energy of this is going to eject this envelope while this is going to ever turn. Unfortunately, this is something that takes a prolonged period of time, much longer than a dynamical on-Milky orbit, and there are very few detailed simulations with all the necessary physics problems correctly, although I understand that there are people right now in Morehouse and Gang who are going to try to do hydrodynamic simulations once again, following Ron's original work. That being said, right now, we're just going to put a number and say, some fraction of this energy, of the gravitational energy, goes to unbinding the automobile. One of the many uncertainties we have. So, because metallicity means you have more metals, it means you have a different path. So, if you have solar metallicity, you have high opacity. So, your high mass compact objects will blow up a lot of material. And this is a function of the initial progenitor mass of your star, the final mass of your remnant. And you can see that with solar metallicity, you're not going to get very massive remnants. Whereas with low metallicity stars, the strength of your stellar winds as you evolve is less, and therefore you can make very, very, very large remnants. Now, you may not believe that these exist, but these are also. So, metallicity means you have bigger black holes. You have more inertia in those mass transfer phases, which affects how tight you can get, and can prevent something from emerging. It also influences how stars expand. So, at solar metallicity, you go through a rapid expansion phase, whereas at subsolar metallicity, you have a rapid expansion phase. And so, if you're basically any separation between here and here, which, because you're equally likely at each logarithmic interval of separation to be in that logarithmic interval of separation empirically, we believe that. You're pretty likely to interact with space. Whereas at subsolar metallicity, you're much more likely to interact in a much better behaved phase, where mass transfer is less likely to be unstable in a way that will drive you to all the way to murder. So that's why we think that metallicity matters. If you get bigger black holes, you can be farther away. And more likely to survive merger. You're more likely, because of the way your star expands, to do mass transfer in phase that is not going to basically cause your binary to go away. Now, there's a lot of uncertainties in these calculations. So it's very, it's difficult to express the accuracy to which any of these parameters will allow. But there's also effects that the wind affects, you can say more much, it also affects when it takes a few blades to kind of fix even a current high mass black hole. There is significant uncertainty as to what the significant depends on who you talk to, as to whether or not the initial mass function is going to be the same at low density. Let's brush that under the rug for a moment and assume that, with the exception of the two essential features that I talked about before, and this key uncertainty about whether or not, if you have a mass transfer in this rapidly expanding phase, whether or not you can survive at all or not, just vary these parameters. Metallicity and this model plan. So the first estimate that you can do, this is a paper that Chris and his student will read on. Where we're basically saying, what if we have 100% transformation at point one, which is a good way up that slope versus solar galaxies. And you saw this summarized in top four. You can see that if you can, even in both cases, whether or not you can survive mass transfer in the Hertz photograph or not, there's a substantial increase, in particular in the binary black hole merger rate, when you go from solar to subsolar. That was something that was already calculated in previous one. And even if you have an admixture, it doesn't take an admixture very much to overwhelm the contribution from solar. Particularly if you are choose the unfavorable choice where anything interacting with Earth from
that. So in the beginning, that will lose me a bit here. The first part I understand from main sequence of massive stars, the winds are driven by radiation pressure resonance marking the metal. So the adolescent metallicity is plausible that you have much less mass loss. And end up with bigger remnants.
Yeah.
The second part, where you talk about the survival.
Oh, it has to do with the quorum below boundary in that.
Okay, so there you're saying the high metallicity, you're more likely to have a virgin.
So it basically has to do with, so we have a flag that says if you have mass transfer occurring, if we don't think that there's a lower solid quorum below boundary, and we have a flag that says basically it's possible to survive, and we terminate boundary at what you estimate the core mass to be, or it's not possible to survive. So those are those two columns.
And by surviving, you mean not merge?
Not merge during this phase. There is a point at which common envelope makes sense to stop, because there is an envelope, and we're with.
Because you eject the envelope?
Yes, because we eject the envelope. And in order to eject the envelope, we have to decide how much mass we're going to eject. It's not something that we can look at. We have a table that says this is mass discovery.
Yeah, you have a table. So are you saying that in the low mass case, you're more likely...
The low metallicity case?
The low metallicity case, you're more likely to eject?
All we're saying is that these two things have different sizes.
Yeah,
so you're more likely to encounter. So this is actually implicitly a statement about the relative size of these for low metallicity versus high metallicity. And it's implicitly a statement about the semi-major axis distribution that you're assuming for progenitor binaries. So we're assuming that for both cases that your logarithm uniformly distributed along in separation. And this is roughly conservative math. And then in that case, just if you pick a random point in the separation, you're much more likely to encounter this phase at solar metallicity than this phase at solar metallicity.
Right, this is just some well-behaved phase. What is the significance that this is a phase in which you get a very rapid expansion of the envelope? Of the massive star. For some reason that gives a much larger expansion in the high metallicity case than so this is something that comes out of
this is the standard solar evolution graph.
So this is the part where a massive star becomes a giant, and which there's never been a very good qualitative explanation. It comes out of people's computer code. It's not necessarily dependent.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what.
And you can do this with Facebook or whatever you do.
Yeah.
Okay.
What would be his explanation? Why it matters? So what happens when you partner? Intersects the HTTP.
Oh, what happens here? Yeah, I guess I did go to that. So what, it's basically, we have more. I said how phenomenological it was. So what you have is a massive star. So common envelope means that you take the gravitational energy of the envelope and you tear it off. Tear off the envelope and you send it to infinity. And you're left behind the core, and this energy goes into taking this companion and bringing it over. Now, in order for this process to work, if you imagine them kind of differentially stripping off layers of material, for example, which you can do, you can write a study and do things that way, you have to know where to stop. And so, if you look at stellar structure profile, I mean, people talk about how stars fall down the core, they have shell learning. There's often a very well-defined core envelope boundary. Whereas for very massive stars, this boundary is not as well. I don't have a slide on this. I don't have a lot of explanation that I can pull out that will convince you. But if you want to talk about it, so that's something we'll get out to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So these numbers should be compared, this is that oval over here, if you remember the first slide, with how many events that you would expect for the advanced LIGO network, which is this green line here. And this number is significant. This is the log of the detection rate. This is a cumulative distribution. So there's a good chance that you'll have 10 to maybe hundreds of double black hole mergers a year. But if you include the effect of metallicity, and these calculations were done assuming continuous star formation, so what we're really doing is we're assuming that there's star formation. And there's roughly two times. So we subdivide this into two parts. We have a chunk at slightly lower metallicity, and a chunk that's like the so we have two, we basically have two bins. And but these two bins are pretty close together, and we had when we had done this calculation originally, we did not go low enough in metallicity to get the dramatic effect that we saw. And when you look at how metallicity evolves with time, it evolves quite substantially. We didn't put any time dependence in. We had just done those two bins, those two bins over in that set over there, with constant metallicity in each bin, which happens to be. We didn't put in any distribution. And if you look at the distribution of galaxies, of the metal content of galaxies, so I showed you before that the previous plot, so this is a similar plot, but instead of comparing within a galaxy, what we're doing, this is from Andrew and all this, is observations of nearby galaxies. You go, you look at the galaxy, you look at its stellar population, you reconstruct its mass, its star formation history, metal content. So this is a plot of the log of the stellar mass of the galaxy log versus the log of the metallicity over solar, so this is solar. And you can see that what we had been previously assuming was basically taking two points equivalently about this line and about this line. And what we really need to do is to account for the fact that there's a significant fraction of just mass right now. We've only got a large fraction of mass, but we don't need a lot of mass because that massive factor, this fraction, needs to be included. So this is interesting. This says, on purely theoretical grounds, that we ought to have a lot of emerging compact binaries, emerging compact black holes in particular. And that's great. Why don't we see them? Well, okay, they're black holes, so we would see any black holes, but that's great, why don't we see them? And at that time, the dime will get you a very small fraction. Actually, I've got one for you. So I guess we can say that.
you need to do to prove an outlandish claim that LIGO maybe ought to be seeing something right now is have evidence that there's something that's going to either is or is definitely going to be a merging compact, merging double black hole binary with the high mass that you expect from low metallicity star formation. And so Tomek, Blick, and Chris, they actually have a paper on this, a couple of papers that we found, ICPEM, Nexlon, and another, oh, they have the wonderful number there. These are X-ray binaries where the black hole is inferred to be massive, and the Penny is a massive star with relatively inferred to have relatively low metallicity. And as they infer, as a result, that it's going to end up as a relatively massive double black hole binary. And that suggests, and event rate for unit volume per time, or event rate for unit volume, that is comparable to, not ridiculous, the ridiculously high end that we could potentially get all star formation of relative metallicity, but well within the, well higher than the sort of event rate that we have been talking about for previously. In particular, the event rate would be predicted to be one or so. So this is just like the binary neutron star case. We know what the sensitivity of our X-ray survey was. I personally do not know because I'm not an X-ray star, but I trust that they did this correctly. And based on that and two events, they get a simple response statistic that says this is what the likely event rate needs to be in order to explain the response rate.
And this is what initially. There.
But you know, this, of course, this is not a direct, this is not like the binary pulsar case, because you have to assume that these are going to eventually form a merging binary with the mass that they predict. Depends on the total mass of the binary, when it finally reaches the merging base. So maybe it will come along with mass.
And so to go from the
weight
per megaton to the event rate as some assumption being built in how massive black holes
are. How massive black holes will be, yes. And I do not have that plot. It is in Chris and Tomek's paper, what I'll say. What based on these, but I can go back to the plot all the way back where they had the initial and final mass distribution that we can graph and put from the brain. If they don't get that much less massive, if this were a solar metallicity star, this would get much less massive before it finally merged. But this is an inference. So, but this is a desirable inference because this is not outside the realm of things that have already been published. And certainly, I would imagine, though cannot comment that this is not a LIGO talk, that further studies are being done.
So this is on the limit from initial LIGO on?
This is a plot of for as a function of mass. And this is a circle containing the, a very large circle containing those where those binaries would be, and you can see that the limits from this paper, which my after list is set on, are comparable to this number. And there are people in this room who perhaps can put their LIGO hat on and comment further on that.
So what was the previous rate? This is a rate for volume. I don't know exactly how far out these things can be detected by a LIGO. But, well, that was the previous.
That's the volume, right?
What was the previous? I mean, you just took the old estimates, the standard estimates. Well, the current LIGO. How much smaller was it than this?
We were assuming that they would reach design sensitivity for a single detector. So these are, you can extrapolate these. I don't remember the exact number that we used, but I believe for, did I actually show you the green one? The green purple was for advanced LIGO. But for initial LIGO, we typically use a single detector, about 50 megabits, at 1.4. And then so you would extrapolate that up roughly linearly, so increasing the range by a factor. So it would be smaller. This sensitivity range is smaller, and therefore the far limit would be we're assuming not a large part. So we would expect that you would see more sources. So it's not a fair apples to apples. But phrasing it in this way, I mean, it's easier to do the comparison if you phrase it in the 33 unit volume. Because you can say the region, you can say what the region detector is when you do an actual search, as opposed to doing a zero estimate and saying, I ought to be able to reach in jealousy and noise due to 15 parts. And this is really the right apple to apples number that you want to compare.
Okay, but how much does that number change? Just the rate, not the rate of detection.
If you actually were to go
with the sensitive. Yeah.
If you had it with a detector that was as sensitive
no,
as
no, no, forget about the detector. Just
yeah.
Worry about what happened.
Oh, what is the volumetric effect?
Yeah, yeah. How much does this change because of the metallicity?
Well, then this would include this is an observational wave, so this is not a theoretical wave. This number here is inferred from observations of these two things plus X-ray from. So this is including no besides. Okay, it's including a little theory to try to infer that these are double black holes. But so it does implicitly include the effects of metallicity to get the mass of the remnant. And so if your question is, if I were to change the mass of the remnant, what would I infer about this rate? I do not actually know that answer. My guess
What is that rate? That's a rate of per megaparsec for million years.
Mm-hmm.
Of what?
Of
mergers that LIGO can detect, or
Events that are like this, these binaries forming in a given volume for a given time.
Yeah, okay, that's fine. But if you had not included this low metallicity enhancement, you would have gotten a lower rate. Right?
So I need to distinguish between. So there's the low metallicity enhancement that we were doing previously, where this is all pure theory, right? This is, I have to start from gas, I turn my theory extension, and I get out a number for how many things LIGO can detect.
No, then there's this thing. Not how many LIGO can detect. Just, this number has nothing to do with LIGO detection. Mm-hmm. This is just...
Well, so are you saying you want me to turn out the equivalent number?
This is just the number of black hole plus neutron star binaries that merge per unit volume per unit time, right? Mm-hmm. In the universe.
Yeah.
Predicted.
Yeah. No, this isn't predicted. This is...
There's these two systems that use these units on mass detection, and they argue that it's no one that they will call.
No, right? So this is a...
This is based
on observation.
Yes!
Based on observations.
So this number, but the problem is the reason I was so confused by your question is it does depend on what we assume about metallicity, because to get from the observed systems to this prediction, you have to assume what the metallicity of the final black hole, what the mass of the black hole.
You have to figure out what's the probability that these two systems are actually going to
end up being a merger. That depends very sensitively as well.
The
cube of mass, right? So this goes as the range. This is divided by this is the volume. So it has your detection volume in it. Your volume basically goes roughly to mass cube. Therefore, it's quite sensitive on what you assume the final mass of the black hole will be that comes from what is currently a star. Because the effects about the mass and mass ratio were less sensitive to a high mass ratio.
Okay, so I could interpret this as the rate, the volumetric rate of merger.
It's a volumetric rate
of forming something big enough.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes two black holes or white hole or neutral star. That's metallicity dependent based on the number of these binaries that you've seen. It's two, yeah.
It's a rate of something. We know this is I misspoke earlier. This is you're perfectly right. This is an event rate for your volume of forming something. But what goes in which bin is the rate for, we don't know. Because we don't know what the final remnant properties are.
Yeah, okay. So if you say that this is the rate of something that So this is a significant fraction of its energy in gravitational waves as opposed to doing something completely different. And that's metallicity dependent, right?
As to which, what type of final object it is,
yeah,
and what it does. That's
metallicity dependent.
Yeah, so we have a rate of forming, in some sense, we have a rate of forming this. And we say that rate is the same as the rate of forming a black hole binary with certain, with basically a merging black hole binary with certain mass. But that doesn't change the fact that it's still an event rate per unit volume. Because this doesn't involve light. This involves light.
Right.
Did anyone else catch that clarification, or is this? Okay. I apologize that this did not come up.
They're all young. They do much better than I do. I'm just asking the question. I'm more confident.
No, sometimes these things go by and you think that you've actually communicated something in the back. So it's good to have something to clarify that. All right, so you saw this, going back to the previous plot, that includes the LIGO detection factor, which I was not doing previously. You remember the previous answers were here. If you include a small fraction of low metallicity star formation, you go there, and that's great. But as you know, I can change the answer that I get from binary evolution by turning the button. So, and that in particular affects the relative importance of this beacon, and how long it takes binary compact information. I can tune my knobs. It's difficult, but I can tune my knobs so that most merging binary black holes from low metallicity star formation work quickly, not out of the. So this will migrate your answers. And it is important, we now recognize that this is important, and we go back and we do these calculations, we can include the fact that there is a dependence on metallicity, but we still have to turn all the knobs that we usually turn, and that means we're still going to get a wide range of answers. It's just that now, in some sense, the range of answers will be wider if we're just predicting this one number, how many events will I see. So in some sense, we've lost, but we've also gained, because we are now predicting that there will be a trend with metallicity, and we know that the universe changes with time, for example. So in the early universe, we should preferentially form more massive black holes than that. And so if we look out in the universe and have some way of weighing black holes in a really far way, and comparing them to black holes here, then we can say, oh, this population is fundamentally different. What has changed from now? The typical method, for example. So that's one way that you might go about breaking this degeneracy that we have in the total number. Now it so happens that we have a wonderful way of eventually measuring the mass of distant compact objects in the very early universe, as opposed to things that we just see now. It's called third generation gravitational wave detectors. You just take your gravitational wave detector now and make it more sensitive. And because the number of sources that you see goes as the distance roughly cubed, once you get up to cosmological distance, it's quite simple, as you know. A very small increase in sensitivity, factor of 10, pays enormous dividends because you see most of the universe, including the epoch of deep star formation. So this is terrible. I apologize. This is the log of redshift. This is roughly the detection horizon in the log of redshift, three-ish, of a third-generation detector for double neutron stars. This is a low-mass source. You can see all the high-mass sources out over here. And this is the log of the number of events per redshift interval. So you have 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 sources. So you can do a lot with 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. You can bid in little tiny intervals in redshift and measure the mass distribution you spin, assuming that you can measure this properly. We can talk about that afterwards. And compare the mass distribution you spin, mass distribution to light rate, and see if this thing evolves. That's one way of breaking it. You know what your TVs are, and I'm done, so skip that. But there's another prediction. If binary compact objects are indeed what powers short-term bursts, then this will make, and low metallicity star formation is a really significant player in what causes binary compact mergers to form, not just for binary black holes, but black hole neutron stars. I didn't emphasize that, but that's also the case. Then there ought to be a preferential bias towards low metallicity for short-term bursts. And this is something that you don't have to wait 10 years to test, 5 years to test. because we've seen short derivatives go up and look on catalog, and I just skipped the introductory review of this material. But there's plenty of short derivatives to be found. And if indeed these things are powered by the disruption of neutron stars, well, that makes an electromagnetic counterpart. We saw the photons. We can see where it came from. We can look at the host galaxy that was born in, where by host we mean something that's relatively close. We can talk about that afterwards. And you can say, are they typical mass and typical redshift? Typical mass and typical metallicity. And I would argue, so these are dots for short periods, that if you look at this particular plot, there is some hint that these with identified hosts might be preferentially lower. This would also predict, because when a star explodes, you impart particles. And in fact, many people see, and part of the reason why people believe short gamma ray bursts are mergers, is that sometimes you treat short gamma ray bursts with what looks to be no hosts. A significant fraction currently, I think Ito recently said about a quarter, don't appear to have hosts. And the reason that this is considered support for a binary merger hypothesis is that when you blow up a star, but the kick and the asymmetric supernova, there's a kicking part of the neutron star. If you don't disrupt the binary, you don't have to momentum. So this is essentially binary careening across from the galaxy or possibly out of it. So that's great. Why do you care about this in relation to low metallicity? Because low metallicity galaxies in mass metallicity relation right here typically have low mass and low running energy. So if there's a strong bias in metallicity, there will be a strong bias. There may be a strong bias, depending on any physical parameters, in the fraction of short derivatives with no
low. So long derivatives have a low mass.
There's this Minucci paper about the fundamental mass. So long JV is associated with star formation.
They're at higher redshift.
They're at higher redshift. So you have to compare apples to apples. Right there, right? You look at the plot, they're there. And if you look at it, I have to interrupt the Minucci. So you can do key. This is all long here. I'm pretty sure this is all long here. So this is a paper from Minucci et al., and I don't have a key. This is my bonus one. And this is a standard math that was. And you can see that long JVs, if you look at the mass metallicity relationship in this way, do indeed look like they are formed from low metallicity star formation. These people are arguing that because they're associated with star formation, that maybe the right thing to look for is something that weights not just by mass and metallicity, but takes into account star formation. And so it's possible that in some sense, what you want to ask is, are the host galaxies of long JVs and short JVs atypical? In particular, for long JVs. And if you just look at two parameters and look at this correlation, then it appears that the host galaxies of long JVs look atypical. In particular, they look atypical towards the low metallicity. But if you take into account the fact that long JVs are born preferentially in star-forming galaxies are often low metallicity. And so if you fold metallicity into this correlation, and this is the extent to which I have thought about this, is verified that indeed they will lie on the correlation that includes this. I'm not sure that this is relevant for the problem that we're talking about in terms of short JVs because of the long relation. So it's not, I think that the relevant correlation is in fact mass metallicity. I do realize that in some sense what you want to do is see whether or not the host galaxies are typical, not whether or not they look like they have low star formation. The one problem that we have is, that's the final point. All right, so we want to test, what we would really be smoking gun for this, if you look at a host or a gamma ray burst, and you see, aha, I know what the birth metallicity is of this binary, but looking at its local environment, and because I can resolve a really tiny region around it, and this little tiny bundle of gas has really low metallicity. And the gamma ray burst went off in there, presto, it's definitive proof of this model. But because these are kicked, these are within a galaxy, the galaxies have been mixed, there's a long delay, kicked, the average metallicity near any individual gas packet is not a very good tracer at all of the birth metallicity, particularly if you have a strong bias towards low metallicity. So what I had hoped would be true, that you would be able to directly distinguish this by looking at the environments of the host. And you can do with supernova 1A. There are nearby galaxies where you can look at NAOZ. Has done these wonderful studies where it's looking at the delay time of distribution of supernovas and tracking them between individual regions in nearby galaxies. And so he'll look at little chunks of those galaxies, and he'll reconstruct the properties of each chunk. In particular, he's looking at the star formation, but he also gets the metallicity of the chunks. And in principle, you could do this with a resolved region of any galaxy you see if it's sufficiently defined, bright, and close, and you've got the resolution. And my personal feeling is that while it is really exciting to explore that direction of things for doing supernova 1A reconstructions, it's not clear to me that we'll ever get the sort of smoking gun. We'll still have to rely on these indirect inferences about the relative significance of dwarf galaxies until, of course, we get this third generation detector. But I'm a gravitational wave person, so that's not working for us. In any case, I think it's fair to say that it's pretty likely, my bias now is that a high gravitational wave, the event rate is quite high. Given our assumptions, but we've seen no reason to change those assumptions. And if you change what we believe about the binding energy of stars, if you come up with a better table, or you've done new hydrodynamic simulations, like how mass transfer extension in the time envelope phase, or the extent to which asymmetric supernova explosions kick black holes, we make assumptions about all these things. But even if you change those assumptions a fair amount, it's still fairly likely because the bias towards metallicity is so strong just from the volume, because you have an overall mass of remnants, it's fairly likely that because we haven't included that before and we're including that now, that there's going to be a lot of remnants on that. Now, this paper is not yet because they're working. We're trying to vary all of our knobs, improving our binary evolution model, and trying to polish off the last details of those comments about short JVs that I made very vaguely at the end. And trying to see the extent to which these things can be fit into binary predictions for not just merging gravitational wave sources, because eventually we'll have this wonderful census of 10 to 5 merging gravitational with merging compact black hole elements in the binaries. This will explicitly measure something. But we also have a lot of other binaries that we see. Post-combinatorial binaries, SDFS, and X-ray binaries, subdwarf binaries, which are the original motivation for stuff. And you have to have a model that not just predicts one thing right, but predicts everything. That's a long time. And it's still underway. And I think I'll jump in. Thanks.
Questions?
This for observing mergers, does the spin of black holes matter at all for how well you can observe them? Is that do you expect that to be impacted by all of this metallicity?
Well, so there are some people, for example, who invoke rapidly rotating low metallicity stars from black stars, and we believe that that angular momentum should be conserved, then why won't you have rapidly rotating remnants? And spin is an enormous effect, as the numerical data analysis can tell you. It is incredibly vital because, for example, as the most trivial case, it changes the size of the horizon, it changes when black hole neutron star liners are heavily disrupted. And that changes, that's an entirely different frequency scale. And that frequency scale can move closer or farther away. So neutron stars' characteristic frequency is like kilohertz, and our LIGO sensitivity is very poor and steeply sloping. So it makes a big difference if you you cut off this closer in band, because you're more likely to be able to identify what this is, as opposed to having your merger appropriate. So spin is important, and it's even your work.
But is it important for actually black hole mergers?
Yes, because they also, so they, it also causes them, so I'm trying to make it talk. So there's spin orbit and spin coupling that causes the binary to spin one thing, recess. And gravitational wave emission is much stronger along the orbital angular momentum direction. And so you just, for example, you get amplitude modulations, just the most naive thing. You also get very, much more important, you get very strong phase modulations. If this is circular polarized one way, and this is circular polarized another way. So it is a huge effect. And you must use, to correctly understand what you have seen, it is vital to use a fully circular. It may be possible to detect a very high max signal with a fully circular. Let's suppose you have a complicated signal, but all the complication is over here. You see the merger, and it's complicated, but you don't know what it is. It's still a big burst of gravitational waves. It may be possible to resolve short signals with an unmodeled approach. But this circuit for a big one. But it's almost always better to do a search with that one exception. We have the merger current band. We have a signal model. And it's essential to do any parameter estimation. You obviously can't understand what you've seen.
Well, metallicity makes it better to lose your envelope. On the other hand, when you lose your envelope, you tend to lose a lot of energy. And because the mass comes off from a large radius, it makes a lot of energy. So as far as having a fast spin,
so we do track the spins of the black holes in our code with various effects. And we take that into account. But I don't think I've done a one-to-one comparison between that before.
Galaxy mass versus metallicity. Did you put those two together to get a...
I was hoping to have the dungeon stuff.
Estimate of what the actual advancement you would expect.
Yeah,
below metallicity.
You can do it to order of magnitude just by eyeballing it. It's very large. The problem is it really does depend on... The problem is we have... so we have mass metallicity relations. You can make the eyeball refraction. Anything below about here, and one fraction mass is then multiplied by high power. That's the eyeball number. But it depends on whether or not you weight by total mass, how the mass is assembled over time. So what the way that we're currently doing the calculation, what we're doing right now is we're taking a bunch of different binary collision models, and we're following. You take a mass metallicity more or less of this, with some fixed galaxies. We glue that onto, within each galaxy, I have halo models of chemical architecture. So I get a metallicity distribution within the galaxy. This is why I tell them the metallicity distribution will also be. And so we are doing the full formal calculation, and the answers can be long. However, it's possible to make the large effect to go away by certain inputs of this.
We should probably use people who have been using cows for cars. So,
oh, yeah.
I didn't say that.
I can show you preliminary answers, but I can't use a fully sample result. So I can show you in a couple of different ways.
Okay. So,
yeah.